So good morning everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Good morning.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Good morning.
Yes. Yeah. Good morning to all. Yeah. Thank you all for joining. And I can see JB here. Thank you, JB, for joining. And also our guest has joined today. So first of all, Shayon, are you able to hear me?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah. I can hear you. Okay. Yeah. Just a second, people are still joining in. Just give me another minute.
Good morning, Ritik.
Yes, good morning, JB.
Okay. Why a special mention for me? Aren't the teachers supposed to join as well?
Yeah. Yeah, but yeah, I think Sushmita Di and everyone else is also going to join.
Yeah, that is what I think.
Yeah,
so
I
too.
Noticed that you joined first.
Yeah, I am first.
Okay, so I think we should start now. So let me first introduce our guest today. So I sincerely thank Shayon for finding the time to join and to speak to our students today and deliver this lecture. So a little bit about Shayon and then we can start. So Shayon used to be my classmate back at Presidency. And now he's a researcher at the Department of English at the University of North Bengal. And we even co-authored a paper several years ago. And it was published by the Global Media Journal. So this was quite a long time ago. But so I think Shayon's topic today is rereading Vivian DeRozio's poetry. Actually, it has a prefix, which I forgot to mention as I read it to you. So the title of the entire lecture is Engendering the Nation, Rereading Henry Louis Vivian DeRozio's Poetry. So Shayon, would you like to take over now?
Yeah. So I hope that I'm audible.
Students,
yes,
can
sir,
you please
audible.
Confirm? Yeah.
Yes.
So I would like to thank Ritik for inviting me, first of all, and the respective professors as well for joining. And my topic today is Engendering the Nation, Rereading DeRozio's Poetry. And as you can see from the title itself, I will be talking about a lot of things. I have chosen this word engendering very carefully because I had kind of talked to Ritik and kind of made him kind of change the first two words. I have kept EN, the word EN, in brackets in engendering, because as you know, that engendering means basically an origin point of a particular concept. And I have kept it in brackets deliberately because I'll be also talking about this gendered view of the nation at the same time. And we'll be discussing DeRozio's role in this context. And what is very important to understand is that I will start with this short anecdote, which I'll come back to later on. I'll be talking about DeRozio, but I'll start with this short anecdote, which will be very interesting for you to learn, because it was in the editorial which was entitled Bongo Bongo Andolan. It was in 11th April in 1947, in a news magazine, where the editorial had kind of accused the Congress and the Hindu Mahasabha of playing the role of Parashuram, because they together, the Hindu Mahasabha and the Congress, had taken this axe to slice the mother into two. And this analogy is very, very important, because when you have this idea, or when you are referring to Parashuram, it's very important, because the mythology of Parashuram is very important in the sense that Parashuram, as you know, was the son of Rishi Jamadagni and Renuka Devi. So what happened was that Rishi Jamadagni had five sons, and Rishi Jamadagni had kind of ordered his sons to kind of kill their mother individually, all the four sons had kind of failed to do so, but it was Parashuram, or Ram initially his name, who had obeyed his orders and lifted the axe or kuthar, Parashu, and struck the fatal blow. So this particular image is very important because, as you know, I have mentioned already, him with their mother, which is the motherland, which is India. Now, this image of India as the motherland is something which I will discuss later on. But what I'll start with is I'll go back to Jerusalem and give you a little bit of about Jerusalem and the angles which I'll be discussing about. I'll be discussing that those things in details later on. So, as you know, that it was in this field of literature, especially poetry written initially in English and eventually in the regional languages, that the first attempts were made to kind of forge a national history of India. And this whole tradition of the 19th century poets brought about by Indian writings for the first time about India as a historical entity kind of constructed the sense of nationhood through the visions of a shared past. So people were starting to refer to a past, and this was very important. And historians and social activists and political scientists have kind of emphasized that this politically, this Indian nation was given substance only at the end of the 19th century. So it is over here where Dirozio becomes very important, because he was the first among the modern poets of colonial India to kind of forge such a language of nationhood. And as you know, that his poems were published from the Baptist Mission Press, later on from the Samuel Smith Company. And he is important because he is the source of the phenomenon today, which we call Indian writing in English. And apart from that, we also know that he played a significant role in the earliest attempts at the creation and definition of a modern Indian identity. Now, as you know, that he was a student of the Scotsman David Drummond, and he was himself a poet, philosopher, and skeptic. And Dirozio's origin was part Portuguese and part English. So he mixed, he kind of got his education from a school in Dharmatala, where with the European and Eurasian native lads, who kind of were taught the same lessons by Drummond. And it was in his early experience of secular kind of cosmopolitanism that led Dirozio to kind of announce himself categorically as an East Indian. So, as you know, and he's very famous for teaching in the Hindu college, and his enormous influence as a teacher, which led to a group of radicals who gathered around him, who were later called the Young Bengal, who were applying his theories to their lives, and only to find themselves as being creators of violent upheaval in the fabric of the civil society in Calcutta. And this unrest kind of led him to kind of resign from his job. What is important to understand is that Dirozio was not only a nationalist, but he also had this patriotic impulse in him, and which kind of found its ultimate fulfillment in the first half of the 20th century, and kind of related to that. But when Dirozio published his first poem, which was in praise of India, this was a very important event which happened. And before kind of going into that, I'll kind of give you a slight understanding about the difference between what is nationalism and what is patriotism. As you know, that nationalism gives more importance to unity by a way of cultural background, often invoking particular political beliefs. But patriotism, on the other hand, pertains to the love for nation and, more importantly, to values and beliefs. So Dirozio was a figure who significantly played this role in some of the earliest attempts at the creation on and definition of a modern Indian identity. And as kind of Rasika Chaudhary had kind of stated, that as a representative of the Indian modern, DiRozio had kind of modeled himself as a kind of self-consciously nationalist poet, addressing all of India in his sonnets. He kind of imagined a nation into being in lines of romantic poetry that spoke of national aspiration and endeavor. And in his poetry, we see the images of national greatness, which coexist with golden age mythology, the praise of mythical heroism. There is reference to great valor. And there are these things kind of contribute to this definition of the polity's desire in a citizen of the nation. And the vocabulary and the iconography are very patriotic, and the construct and these constructions and notions of indigenousness might have been borrowed from Scott and Byron, but it has its own base. So what is even more problematic, or what I kind of wanted to locate, is that we've always imagined the nation as being feminine, as being motherland, as being feminine counterpart. And this has proved to be highly problematic. Now, I have kind of located that this tradition of presenting this nation as being feminine gets its origin from DiRozio's poetry itself. And long before the emergence of the concept of Bharat Mata or Bharat Borsho or whatever you call it, which was used as a tool in the Indian freedom struggle, it was DiRozio in 1827-28 who imagined the nation as being a female deity, female goddess. And it can be said that he is the precursor of this concept of engendering the nation. Because DiRozio's formation of Mother India was very identical with the conception which Aurobindo, Bankim had kind of presented. And this idea or concept of the motherland, Desh Mata or Bharat Mata, was kind of stated to be a cultural artifact by Kanika Sarkar. And DiRozio's India is a gendered female who rides in galling chains when her proud masters scourge her like a dog. So these lines are from The Golden Vase. It's a poem by DiRozio. And engendering the nation itself later on turns into a patriarchal idea in DiRozio's poetry. And 19th century Indian society nourishes the idea of this household or this housewife as being the Hindu goddess Lakshmi. I'll kind of elaborate these things, but we'll just mention them first. By whose grace the extended family, the clan, Bharat Lakshmi, lived and prospered. So women were always kind of shown to be weak, and they should naturally honor the nation. Men, on the other hand, are expected to build up this Mother India and should rush to her relief. So it kind of automatically posits the woman in a weaker position. Now, pointing towards this idea of the nation being feminine or this idea of motherland, it's very important to understand one or two things. The first thing is that it revealed this male anxiety and fantasy at the same time. When westernized nationalists like Nehru relied on metaphors of sexual aggression in the critiques of violence perpetrated by their colonial masters, it was people like Sarah Suleri who had objected to this equation between this colonized landscape and the female body. So when you say that India is in a very bitter condition, when this colonized landscape called India is in a very bitter condition and you are equating it with the female body, you are automatically saying that the female is automatically weak. And the motherland, which is very important to mention, it's very problematic because it also damages this idea, this comparison between the colonized landscape and the female body. It also damages the theoretical, it causes rather theoretical damage to to this contemporary feminist and post-colonial discourses at the same time. So what Sarah Suleri had also pointed out, that this colonial gaze were not exactly colonial at times. It was kind of inherited by the westernized reading, and this was very problematic at the same time. So the motherland is very important over here. It's often that people see that it is opposed to this idea. It's just the opposite of the idea of the European conception of the fatherland. But what you have to understand is that while the European conception of the fatherland was clearly metaphorical, the motherland was not. It was actually referring to a reality in this concept. What was that? It was not from a mere idea or a fancy, but it had its own distinct personality. So the mother or the motherland was actually the woman who bore her children, nursed them, and brought them up with her own life and substance, and was no more real a personality in their thought and idea than the land which bore and reared and gave food and shelter to their race. So there is this clear analogy which is being given. Now, apart from this, and people like Bipin Chandra Pal had also kind of adhered to this conception of the motherland being equated with mother nature. And he kind of claims in Shankar philosophy it was always there, in Hindu philosophy it was always there. But what is also important is that it was not only an Indian concept. Mother nature was not strictly an Indian concept. It was also a European concept which we find in the 16th and 17th centuries. So this is something which you have to understand. And apart from this, when we say that our motherland, that the idea of mother or the female principle of Shakti which is presented, or the deity or the goddess which you find in Derozio's poetry as well, this parallel between mother goddess, where we draw these analogies in order to show an empowered nation, what we do is that we are kind of presenting an image of goddesses. We are referring to goddesses who are actually quite empowered, like Durga or Kali, but when we depict them, we depict them with the shade of weakness. Because if you see Bharat Mata, for example, which is painted, which is very famous by Abanindranath Tagore, it actually depicts this archetypal female victim. And what happens is that there's this comparison which is drawn, where we have the image of the Shrinkhalita Bharat Mata, the mother who is bound in chains, which was widely used as an image in the nationalist discourse. And there was these analogies between Ma ki chilen or Ma ki hoyechen, which is the way mother had been and what has happened to our mother now. This idea of the mother is very, very important, because firstly, it's given an emotional angle to this nationalist project, because the mother kind of embodies this emotion. So when you say Maer ki chilo ma ki hoyeche, there is this emotional angle which is always there. And secondly, which is very important and people don't mention, is the figure of the mother is always something which is presented in an asexual manner. We cannot sexualize the figure of the mother. So that is why people have chosen this image of the mother to depict the nation. And you know that this idea of the mother had been kind of written by, and when Aurobindo Ghosh was writing his poetry, he had also used this particular image. And Aurobindo Ghosh had also said that it was only when the mother had revealed herself that patriotism worked miracles and saved a doomed nation. So when you see that this was quite deliberate on their part. And when Bonkim was kind of writing his songs like Bande Mataram in Bongo Darshan, it was eventually sung by Rabindranath. So all of these things kind of brought in this idea. And one of the earliest literary evocations of the concept of Bharat Mata wasn't Dvijendral Roy's song, which was Jedin Shurin Jalanti Hoite Uthile Jalanti Bharatvarsha. So which roughly translates into the day you arose from the blue ocean, Mother Bharatvarsha, the world erupted in such a joyful clamor, such devotion, mother, and so much laughter. So all of these things were very important. Now, what happened was that this image of the motherland, the mother, was, as I said, later on taken up by the nationalists, and they projected this idea in the later half or the end of the 19th century, where the nationalist discourses were kind of gaining base. And what was also interesting was that by the end of the 19th century, the women's question had also disappeared from the public space. And this is very interesting, because before that we had the Bengali Renaissance, where Bidyasagar and Ram Mohan Roy, people like Bidyasagar and Ram Mohan Roy, who were kind of legalizing widow marriage, abolishing kulin pratha, etc. But by the end of the 19th century, something different was happening. The woman, the motherland, who is embodying the nation, and ironically, the woman had no space, had no place in this particular discourse of nationalism. So the woman question disappeared totally, and it was suddenly replaced by direct political questions on nationalism. So with the rise of new nationalism, the project of modernization, which kind of imitated the Western mannerisms, it started to be looked upon with suspicion. And people, like, there was this division between tradition and modern. So when people like Sumit Sharkar point out that the reformers, who did not totally reject the Western ideas, they were very selective of what they would borrow. And while they were being selective, they would not eliminate the patriarchal structure and conservatism in the name of tradition itself. And they kept their women oppressed. So there was this ideological sieve through which the reformers borrowed the Western ideas. And there is this reference to this inner domain of sovereignty, which Partha Chatterjee kind of mentions, where he makes a distinction between the material and the spiritual spheres in the domain on culture. And he states that the material world was domain, material world or domain, whatever you call it, was kind of dominated by the West, as they were more powerful in science, technology, and modern methods of statecraft, which were kind of used as tools to kind of dominate the East. But what the nationalist project did was that even though the British were powerful in the material world, the East, what they kind of stated, that they were much more powerful in the spiritual domain. So it focused on the development of material techniques like that of the West, but retained their spiritual essence of the national culture. And this is how the nationalist project kind of justified its appropriation of the Western modernity. Now, it is very interesting, because this material spiritual argument was further extended to the Ghar and Bahir argument, where the world, which was dominated by the material sphere, and the home reflected the inner and spiritual self. So the home basically would remain untouched from the profane activities of the world, and according to the typical conception of gender roles in the patriarchal structure, the woman is the sole representation of this, or the representative of this home or the inner world. So when we match this meaning of the home world concepts with the identification of social roles by gender, we see how the nationalist framework was operating. And it is this project which used all of these images, which started with Derozio's poetry itself. And what happened, I'll kind of give you more examples about what was happening to women during that point of time. I would refer to Kailash Vashini Devi, who had kind of written in Hindu Mohila Ganer Hinavasta, where she's saying, I'll kind of read the translation. O delusion, when will you leave this land of Bengal, Mother Bengal? When will your daughters be liberated from the darkness of illusion and find happiness in the light of knowledge? How many more years will it be before the minds of women of Bengal are purged of this terrible disposition? And what is this terrible disposition that Devi is referring to? He's talking about this idea of the domestic life, which were kind of forcing women to be civilized. So this idea of civilization, which was a typical European thought, had this universal appeal to it. It had this promise of improvement. So through this idea came the ideas of internal discipline, like shrinkhala, of the home, which was thought to be a stepping stone to prosperity. So all of these things kind of stressed upon the importance of domestic science and dictated their lives, the lives of women. And the public sphere could not be separated from the private. So women were further divided into categories. For example, Olokki, Lokki, all of these dichotomies, Kulota, Bibi, the female form of Babu, Memshai, Bo Babu. So all of these things came together. And these categories came through several books. And there were books on female education, on how they should act, on how they should behave. So if you refer to books that of Bhudev Mukhopadhyay, like Paribarik Probandho or Rajan Bose's Shekal or Ekal, these people are presenting women to be in these clusters where, for example, Rajan Bose is saying that the women of those times were really hardworking, and the women at present, the women of the well-to-do families are kind of completely dependent on the servants, and they are averse to grihokarjo. So because the women are not doing their household work, it's very problematic for them. So the women are reluctant now. So they were more compassionate earlier. So you will find several examples in Bhavanicharan Bandyopadhyay, Ishachandra Bose, Anukul Chandra Dutta. These people were writing on how women should behave, and they were glorifying their tradition and oppressing women at the same time. Now, what is also very important, for example, I will give you a shocking example, which is written by Doaimoni Dashi, which is the name of the work is Potibrata Dharma, which was written in 1870. And she's saying that a woman has no better friend than her husband. He is Swami because it is to him that the body belongs. He is the lord of the body. He fulfills the woman's desires. That is why he is called Kanto. He is Bondhu as he shares happiness. Parampriyo as he gives affection. Ramon because he gives pleasure. It is who through his own semen returns as the sun. And that is why the sun is valued. But for a Kulostri, the husband is dearer than even 100 sons. So you see the level of oppression which was kind of being meted out against women. Now, at the backdrop of this, we see that women are shown to be goddesses as being in the nationalist iconography. We see women as being depicted as goddesses like Shakti. Which is actually a trope of this nationalist iconography. And I was saying that when this 19th century Indian society, which nourishes the idea of the Hindu housewife, like Bharat Lokhi and Griholokhi, this image of Lokhi or Griholokhi is a part of this cryptic cultural code of this steadfast Hindu wife. So the Lakshmi was not an instance of a tradition fighting modernity. The modern Lakshmi was to be produced through education and was a part of this indispensable nationalist project, whose pursuit was to bring a kind of domestic happiness. So we have this Kulostri and Kulota, these kind of images brought together. And we have from there the political metaphor of the nation as the mother, Desh Mata, Bharati, Bhavani, all of these things. And she ends up being this pale stereotype whose power springs from the dependence of this male fantasy and desire. So within this, for example, Bhadradrup culture of modernity, this is what was happening. And I see all of these things together because these images had kind of emerged from a very, very long time. And it is actually D'Arezzo who had started this. And that is why he becomes very important for reading. I'll just read an excerpt from D'Arezzo's The Golden Voice, where you can understand how it was being reflected or how image is being presented. That's the same. So, if I read a few lines from this poem, which is The Golden Vase, it is, as you see, you will see that there, it is fired by this patriotic zeal, which is this unique blend of nationalistic poetry, uses the unique blend of nationalistic poetry. And he's writing that, oh, when our country rides in galling chains, when her proud master scours her like a dog, if her wild cry be borne upon the gale, our bosoms to the melancholy sound should swell and we should rush to her relief, like some at the unhappy parents' wail, and when we know the flash of patriot swords is unto spirits longing to free, like hope returning to light, we should not pause till every tyrant dread our feet, or till we ween, till we find graves. So this, even though this is anti-imperialist, it is actually a reflection of what I was saying. This is what I wanted to discuss in light of this nationalist discourse of the end of the 19th century, which was emerging, and how D'Arezzo's poetry also contributes to this idea of the image of the woman and this image of the motherland. And what was also interesting is that when this evocation of the nation as mother, it also kind of perpetrated two basic images, two strong metaphors, that of the image of food and clothing. So mota khabo, mota poro, which is very important, which the attitude and devotion to the nation as the mother was being made more explicit in another of his songs, which is in Rajinikanth Sen's songs, Amar Nehat Gorib, Amar Nehat Choto, which is also very important. Now, all of these things were being compiled, all of these images were being compiled and being used in particular ways. And this is something which was originally started by D'Arezzo. And this is why I wanted to refer to D'Arezzo as being a person who was engendering the nation in this particular way. So I hope that you could understand what I'm saying. And I think I made myself clear. So if you have any inputs or questions, you may ask me.
Okay, so I sincerely thank Shayan on behalf of the entire English department of Rani Birla Girls College for finding his time to deliver a really insightful lecture. I'm sure many of our students are going to find or pick cues from your lecture and do further research on many of the things which you mentioned and which are surely relevant today, even after 200 years or so. So before we proceed further into the question and answer section, Shayan, may I request you to turn on your camera once?
Okay,
because
yes,
yeah, we can't take photos. As you know, we are in the midst of something known as a pandemic. And had this been an ordinary regular seminar, you would have been present. So yeah, okay. Oh, thank you very much. And students, if you have any questions, please go ahead.
I hope that I'm visible, right?
Yeah, you are. Students, do you have any questions?
Sir?
Yeah.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, is literature or the literary people, the poets and the writers of the 19th century, any way responsible for the oppression of the women?
Look, there is no, there are actually quite a few authors who had kind of had direct contributions to this, which led to the oppression of women. But a few authors and poets did this quite unconsciously, because they were kind of establishing this framework or this idea of this nationalistic framework. And when people like De Rozier were starting all of these these particular discourses, he was not aware of what was going to happen with this particular image. When I kind of present the nation as being a deity, or when I present the nation as being feminine. But it was later on, this image was taken up and subverted. It was taken out and kind of used in specific ways, which actually contributed to this oppression of over women, which I was kind of discussing. So this is something you should understand.
Thank you, sir.
Any other questions, girls? Anything specific to De Rozier, or perhaps related to the question of the woman, as Shyam so aptly pointed out, which was relevant back then and continues to be relevant today. So if you have any related question, please go ahead and ask. All right. So I have to assume
Achha,
that...
I have a question.
Oh yes, please go ahead,
Apalati. Sorry to cut in.
No, sure, please go ahead.
Achha, Shayan, I enjoyed your talk very much. Thank you. It was very interesting. Ami, ekta, out of curiosity, I am asking you this. It is not essentially a very syllabus-oriented point, but since you are talking about nation building and the image of Mother India in that context, you know, nation building, one would imagine it, you know, it implies that it is a pan-India project. Now, from what I understood, you know, this seems to be, you know, this Mother India concept, given your literary references, which are Bengal specific, the project seems to be particularly and peculiarly regionalized. Now, I was wondering if this concept of Mother India is reflected in any other vernacular literatures. Was it being reflected in any other vernacular literatures simultaneously? I am asking you this, as I said, because your range of literary references are essentially Bengali, are second. Since you, of course, very relevantly mentioned that the empowered goddesses, I have a feeling that, you know, such goddesses are might be located essentially, if not in Bengal, at least in northeastern India, by extension Assam. So I was wondering, Jay, how far is this nation building project, anchored in other literatures in India?
Yeah, it's a very relevant question. It's very important, because when you were referring to this idea of the image of the goddess, which has its origin from the Tibetan Buddhism paradigm, which is very important, because for example, my work is also on the Tibetan Buddhist domain. That is why I can kind of understand. What is also important is that when you kind of look at all of these things, is also important to go back and kind of refer to all of these, the origins of these goddesses. For example, the very notion of Dakini, which you can understand, is actually an image of the empowered woman, or the woman who is knowledgeable. And which has its origin, which has kind of traveled into our idea of the Daini. It has been subverted into this idea of the Daini. And originally, all of these images, Ratna Rakini, Vajra Rakini, all of these things which have the links with the Tibetan Buddhist,
Tantric Buddhism, yes.
Tantric Buddhism, exactly. So it has its link to that for our, because our image of the Kali is kind of comes from there.
Yes.
So this is also very important for mentioning, because all of these women were actually portrayed in, because I have kind of focused it on on Bengal because I was talking about DeRozier, but it was actually a pan India project, but it was initially, for example, Obindranath Thakur's depiction of the Bharat Mata, which was kind of critiqued and kind of was taken up later on. It was originally Bongo Mata. It was not Bharat Mata. So it was later on taken up to be Bharat Mata. Bonde Mataramta was taken up later. So all of these things, because what I was kind of trying to focus on was this sentiment of the mother, or this sentiment, this emotional paradigm, which was also being used to kind of manipulate this idea of what was nationalism, what was important, or this when I'm referring to this historical past of India, when I'm ascribing this image of the mother, this image of the feminine, image of this goddess, we are actually referring to a past, and we are kind of glorifying our past. So this is something. For example, Obindranath had also based his painting on his own daughter. The face of Bharat Mata, which we see, is actually based on his own daughter. And Obindranath had kind of depicted it in a very humane way. I mean, it was a very human image. But this ascription of this divine angle was something which was taken up by all of these people of this nationalist project. So it was not originally, which was something which was thought of. Like, as I was seeing in DeRozier's poetry as well, it was not something which was originally imagined. So it was taken up by these people and used in specific ways in order to kind of manipulate and kind of change certain things. And was not restricted to one particular region. I was focusing on this because I was talking about Bengal in specific. But this is something which I kind of tell you as a part of your answer to your question.
So I understand that it is kind of, well, it is regional in a way. The way you have placed it today, at least. But that is a very interesting connection that you have drawn, that, you know, how Tibetan Tantric Buddhism enters into this, very indirectly, of course, enters into this idea of Mother India. I had no clue. Thank you.
Okay, Shayon, we have one more question from another student who has typed it in the, you know, messages chat box. Her question is, was there anyone who understood these things happening back at that time? I believe she's referring to the time when these events were happening, many of which you referred to. And to continue with her question, like the oppression of women while glorifying India as a female, and more specifically a goddess persona while neglecting the real development of women.
This is what I was basing my talk on, basically, which is behind this idea of presenting the woman as a goddess, at this goddess persona, and at the same time neglecting the real development. This is what was happening. And this was when I was saying that education was strictly limited to this upper middle class women. And education was not a part of their choice. It was the education was being mediated by the male, basically the men of the society. And it was consciously, women were kept consciously, were kind of this paradigm of education which was being used. It was consciously kind of keeping women restricted to these boundaries. This is very important to understand, because, and whether was there anyone who understood the things happening back at that time? See, when this was happening, there were actually people who understood this. And as I referred to Kailashvasini Devi, so she was also understanding, because I have referred to this, to her work. She was also writing about this condition of women. And several other people were also kind of writing about the condition of women. But the dominant idea, which was kind of being reflected, was kind of this women question was kind of disappearing under this direct political questions which were addressed along with nationalism. So this was giving priority over the question of women. This is something which is to answer your question, basically.
So essentially, I believe women, just as the case remains to be today, they have, you know, been, you know, portrayed in such a manner that they have become political props rather than anyone working
Props,
for.
They are basically tools.
Yes, yes. So that has been the case, and literature has been instrumental to a great extent.
Whether directly or indirectly.
Yes, yes. So students, any other questions?
Sir, I have a question.
Go ahead.
Sir, actually, I was like searching for this motherland topic on the internet. So I came across a fact that not all countries are really, you know, termed as motherland. I came across that America is neither referred to as motherland or fatherland, but India is often referred to as motherland and some other countries. Sir, is there any significance or reason behind it?
This is what I mentioned in my talk, where I was saying that when in the European countries, it is referred to as the fatherland, as I said, just the opposite of motherland. But there is no metaphoric, it's kind of, it is used in a metaphorical sense. But in case of the motherland, what was being ascribed to this idea and conception was that it was actually being replaced with the role of the mother, who is nurturing her children, who is actually taking care of her children, just like the land would take care of your shelter and provide you with food. So there is this actual reality which is behind this conception of the motherland, which is not there in comparison to the fatherland. So this is something there, and as you have seen, it's not which was often used in several other countries. The motherland was used in a very specific way in order to kind of propagate certain ideas through this conception. So it was quite a conscious thing which had happened. So this is something to answer your question.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
All right. So girls, do any of you have any other question? Okay. So I guess that's it from the students as well. So Shayan, once again, I must thank you on the behalf of the entire department, on behalf of teachers as well as the students. Thank you, Opaladi, as well, for asking a question, for making it more and more lively.
I really enjoyed her question because it's very interesting. I really wanted to discuss the Tantric Buddhism part in detail, but since I don't have the time, I would rather kind of discuss it with her later on. But it's very interesting, and her question was quite interesting, and I really enjoyed it.
Hopefully the times will change, and maybe someday you will visit and lecture at Rani Birla in person. Let's hope that happens someday. So thank you once again. And students, a lot of cues for you to pick from Shayan's talk. And hopefully, apparently from your questions, I was able to gather that some of you have actually. And that is a good sign. I'm glad you have started doing that. It's amazing. So our first session ends here. We'll all regroup again at 1 p.m. to listen to our next speaker, Sritama Bhattacharya's lecture on gender and class boundaries in C.G. Rossetti's Goblin Market. So we'll regroup back then. Thank you, everyone. And once again, thank you, Shayan.
Thank you for calling me.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.